Hi, I'm Colin Derdeyn with the Stroke Council from the University of Iowa, and it's a real pleasure to be here today with Lee Schwamm from Mass General, who is the PI of the MR Witness trial that is being presented today. Lee, could you tell us about the trial?
Sure, Colin. This was a trial that was designed to ask the question, is there a population of patients who present more than 4.5 hours from them when they were last seen well, who still might benefit from intravenous TPA? As you know, our current criteria exclude those patients regardless of the time between when they were discovered to have symptoms and arrive at the hospital and make them ineligible for thrombolytic therapy. And we felt, and others have looked at this, that some of those patients probably had their strokes right when they woke up or right when they were discovered in the middle of the day, and they might be eligible for TPA, and that's what we tried to study.
So what did you find?
Well, what we found is that if we used an MRI scanner and looked at the difference between signal intensity on the DWI, indicating acute ischemia, and the flare, that if the DWI had turned positive and the flare was either completely normal or just slightly positive, that that was a biomarker, essentially, for early stroke duration, and that within 3.5 hours was the time frame that that flare signal would start to increase. So we had essentially a MR witness rather than a human witness to say the stroke was no more than 3.5 hours old. And if that's the case, then we had a chance of treating that patient in the next hour or two with TPA and look to see if there was a good outcome and safety.
So tell me what the results are. What was the
So we enrolled 80 subjects, and our primary outcome was a safety outcome. This was a phase 2 open label study. The assessment of functional outcome at 90 days was done by someone at the site who had not seen the patient before. Any hemorrhage that was seen on any scan was adjudicated by a core lab, and then an independent medical monitor reviewed those to determine if they were symptomatic or asymptomatic. And our primary outcome was we felt that the patients we were enrolling would be quite similar to ECAS-3. So our hemorrhage rate should not statistically exceed the rate of ECAS-3. And so that rate, the upper boundary of the rate in ECAS-3 was 5.3%. So if we exceeded that rate, our trial would have been halted.
Yes.
And the primary outcome was basically one patient out of the 80 had a symptomatic hemorrhage, so a rate of 1.25%.
Wow.
And that was statistically no different than the rate seen in ECAS-3, so we're really excited about that result.
So one out of 83 sounds a lot lower than 5.3%. What were the 95% confidence limits for that rate?
Right, so the 5.3% observed in ECAS-3 had a confidence interval of 3.3% to 7.8%.
Yes.
And our confidence interval was 0.03% to 6.8%.
Very good.
So the numbers in our trial were small. They were, yes, 1/10 the size of ECAS-3. But despite that, we clearly had a low hemorrhage rate, and that signal was extremely reassuring.
So IVTPA given to this population, clearly safe.
Yeah.
Did you get any sense for outcomes, for efficacy, compared to controls or historical controls?
Right. So I think it's a real challenge to decide what the right control group is.
Yes.
We did look at outcome at 90 days. So we had 80 patients enrolled. Of those, 11 of the subjects had a pre-stroke rank in greater than 1. Because this was a safety study.
Okay.
So we know it's safe not just in patients with no pre-existing disability.
Yes.
But to think about outcome of 0 to 1 at 90 days, we, yes, looked at the 69 patients who had a pre-morbid ranking of 0 to 1.
Okay.
And in that population, about 44% of our patients achieved complete independence with no disability, so ranking of 0 to 1.
Wow.
Which we think compares very favorably to some control groups.
Yes.
And modestly to others. So,
yes,
if you look at the time treatment curve,
yes,
from the pooled Lancet analysis,
mm-hmm,
it's not even clear what that benefit would be, but it certainly would be extremely low because after 6 hours it clearly crosses into harm, right?
Yes, so, right.
So in that regard we look good. If you look at the pooled TPA Lancet paper and you look at the subgroups that included 3 to 4.5 hours window of,
yes,
patients above and below 85, outcome there was in the low 30s.
Yes.
However, if you look at ECAS-3 itself, the placebo response group was 45%.
Yes, right. Yes.
So we think that the true effect size is probably somewhere around 48%.
Mm-hmm.
And based on some of the CT wake-up studies and looking at the placebo arms of patients, particularly those above 80, we think it's reasonable to think that about 40% of these subjects might have had a reasonable response. outcome. So looking at an effect size similar to ECAS-3, but with the response rates shifted down a little bit.
That's good. That's great. Did you learn anything about the nature of wake-up strokes in the sense, you screened a lot of patients with MR.
Yeah.
What rate or what percentage of patients with wake-ups had this MR signature of an early stroke?
It's a great question, and I don't think I can give you the answer I'd like to give, because the way that people identified screen failures was different at different sites. Some sites only went to MRI to screen their patient if they were clinically eligible for this trial, and others routinely do MRI.
Okay.
So if they did the MR first and they saw the flare signal was increased, they didn't even count as a screen failure.
Okay.
So of the cases that we have where they were a legitimate screen failure, we were enrolling about 25%, 30% of those cases,
okay,
which I think is a bit of an overestimate,
yes,
of the eligible cases.
Right.
Another way to think about this, too, is 75% of our patients were wake-ups, so they went to bed last night and woke up this morning with,
yes,
their symptoms. 25% were unwitnessed sometime during the day.
Right.
So we have a mixture, actually, and because the MRI biomarker is so accurate,
yes,
for this relationship between diffusion and flare, we felt comfortable with that.
Yes.
In a CT-based study, we know that that's a little bit harder because,
right,
there were patients like that in ECAS-3. They didn't benefit.
Right, right.
Yeah. The other point that I would make, I didn't make it before, the median time from last seen well to treatment in our study, 11.3 hours.
Wow.
So these are patients who nobody has been looking at treating before, and that's,
right,
why we think it's such a fertile area for further research, because it's actually a fair number of patients.
Right. So speaking of further research, what are the next logical steps, knowing what we know now?
So we did a multivariate analysis of outcome, and the predictors of outcome that you would not be surprised to hear would be the lower your NIH stroke scale score, the more likely you are to have a good outcome. Interestingly, lacunar strokes did not respond to treatment in this study. And so one question is, is it a different biology?
Mm-hmm.
Is it just too small of a sample to really understand the impact of those stroke subtypes? But we think the right next step is a phase 3 randomized trial, which we'll be submitting to StrokeNet. And we've decided that we think it's too important of a question to only enroll with MR. And so we've joined together with the investigators who have done preliminary work in CT-based enrollment of wake-up strokes. And so we'll be combining forces and submitting a trial that will use MR or CT to screen patients for enrollment.
How will you, well, that's great, and sounds exciting. How are you going to handle the large vessel occlusion piece of that? Are you in competition with diffuse 3, and how does that fall out?
So our goal is to not be in competition with diffuse 3, and in fact, our goal is to be synergistic with diffuse 3.
Okay.
We've decided that, first of all, we know TPA isn't effective in most cases of large vessel
stroke. Or less effective, yeah.
Exactly. We know that thrombectomy is very potent treatment effect for patients with large vessel stroke.
Yes.
So potent, in fact, that it would swamp any signal that we might have in patients treated with IV TPA, so that if we were to include those patients in our trial, many people would question whether or not IV TPA alone is beneficial in,
yes,
this trial.
Yes.
So we've chosen to exclude those patients. Many of those patients won't qualify for our trial anyway, because if guideline-recommended treatment should start within 6 hours, and you can't even enter our trial unless you're more than 4.5 hours and you haven't had TPA yet,
yes,
it's actually unlikely we would recruit many of those patients. And we strongly believe that we can have a profound impact across the country in small hospitals, in rural country, in rural counties,
yes,
where patients show up with a wake-up stroke and thrombectomy isn't on the table.
Yes. I would also expect that given the diffuse 2 criteria, in terms of allowed size of diffusion abnormality,
yeah,
and flare abnormalities, there's probably a lot of those large vessel occlusion patients may not qualify anyway.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So we really don't think that that's a target population that we need to go after. And the beauty of designing ourselves to be perfectly complementary to diffuse 3,
yes,
is we can then take every diffuse 3 site and enroll,
yes,
them in this study, and anyone,
right,
they screen for diffuse 3 who falls out is a potential candidate for our trial. So,
right,
very efficient from the NIH perspective.
And tell me again, in MR witness,
yeah,
and with the next trial, do you have a name for it yet?
Eyewitness.
Eyewitness. So tell me, what's the time window again for this, for the inclusion criteria?
So the inclusion criteria are you have to be more than 4.5 hours from last seen well. so that you don't qualify for open-label TPA.
Right.
And within 24 hours of last seen well, because the yield is just so low once you go beyond that.
Yes.
And then within those subjects, you still have to treat within 4.5 hours of discovery.
4.5 hours of discovery.
So it's basically like ECAS 3.
Yes.
Except instead of using last seen well as the time you peg, you use time of discovery.
Are you thinking about any of the other ECAS 3 exclusions of diabetes or prior stroke?
So we started the trial excluding patients over the age of 80 and with prior stroke and diabetes. And we found actually through some of our preliminary work looking at cases that we were following concurrently that we didn't think that was a reasonable exclusion anymore. And then there were some papers published during the course of the trial showing that, in fact, retrospectively, those patients don't seem to be at increased risk. So we dropped those criteria now. And we allow subjects up to age 85. We have no minimum NIH stroke scale criteria. We will exclude cases that we think have a high likelihood of being stroke mimics, so pure sensory syndromes or isolated visual disturbance, because the CT arm won't be able to exclude those.
Right.
But we think that the general clinical criteria, we will try to map as closely as we can to those. So for people doing this trial, it's basically what I would normally do, except I'm using symptom discovery instead.
Right. So there was one symptomatic hemorrhage.
Yeah.
Tell me about the asymptomatic hemorrhages. Were there any?
Yeah, actually, they were quite common. About 25% of patients had asymptomatic hemorrhage at 24 hours detected with non-contrast CT. I thought that was a high number till I looked carefully at ECAS-3. In fact, it's very similar to ECAS-3. And we did 30-day follow-up MRI. So we actually saw a very high number of patients with evidence of hemorrhagic infarction, HI1, HI2, in our population. I thought that it might be associated with good outcome. I had the hypothesis that if you had early reperfusion, you would have some minor hemorrhagic transformation, as von Kummer showed in ECAS-2. And I thought it might be associated with better outcome, but in our small sample size, it wasn't.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you, Lee, so much for your time, and congratulations on a great job and an important trial, and best luck going forward with Unwitnessed.
Great, thanks. And I just want to thank all of my collaborators and site investigators who worked so hard to make this trial successful.